This is Angelo Pizzullo, manager of the oral history program with the Battleship New Jersey in Camden, New Jersey. Today is Saturday, May 4th, 2019. We are on board the Battleship New Jersey, and our interview guest is Mr. Carl Haffner from Syracuse, New York. Mr. Haffner served on USS New Jersey from 1955 to 1957 and was a machinist mate third class working in Engine Room 1. Welcome home, Mr. Haffner.
Hi, Coop.
And what is your current age?
85.
All right. And when did you first enlist?
Well, I enlisted in the reserves probably in 1952.
Okay. And what was your, first of all, what was your inspiration for choosing the Navy?
I didn't want to go play in the mud with the Army.
All right. And what was the process to enlist in the Navy?
What was what, pardon me?
The process. What did you have to go through before you enlisted, and what did you go through to enlist?
We enlisted, my friend and I, in a reserve air station in Syracuse. And then when we decided we were going on active duty in January of 1955, we had to go to the naval station in Albany. And then when we got accepted there, then we got had to go wait for our orders, and we went to Brooklyn Naval Yard.
Okay.
And got sworn and everything there.
Great. And where did you go to boot camp?
Bainbridge, Maryland.
All right. Any stories you'd like to share from your time in boot camp?
Not really.
Okay. Now, did you go to an A school?
Pardon me?
Did you go to an A school?
No.
All right. So what kind of training did you have as far as advanced skills? Your job in the Navy?
Well, I wanted to be an electrician's mate because my father was an electrician for the power company at home. And the Navy decided I should be a fireman. And then I was a boiler tender. Then they made me a machinist mate.
Okay. And where did you go to be trained for all that?
Aboard the USS New Jersey.
Oh, okay. So you learned all those job skills while on the New Jersey?
That's right.
All right, so let me backtrack a little bit. When you first found out you were being assigned to New Jersey, the first time you saw those orders, do you remember your reaction?
Well, when I first heard that I was going to New Jersey, or coming to New Jersey, the rumor was around that it was going to Korea. So my mother, and she told me when I went or left home, when you find out where you're going, let me know. So I did. And after a little bit, I found out that the USS New Jersey was in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. It had just come out of the yard in Brooklyn. And they had it down there on the shakedown cruise. And on the way back, I didn't think nothing of it. We pulled in the Norfolk, Pier 7. And the biggest ship I ever seen in my life was right there next to it, the Wisconsin. And they were bringing railroad cars, flat cars, down to the ship. And the cranes are hauling and parking it up on the deck. I thought, my God, where are you going? And then all of a sudden somebody said, you know where you're going? I said, no, Korea, I think. No, you're not. You're going to the Mediterranean. And I thought that was great.
Mm-hmm. So you just described the first time you saw the Wisconsin.
Yeah.
Did you react the same the first time you saw the New Jersey?
Yep.
And what was that like, knowing it was your ship?
I couldn't believe that they made something like that and it floated. You know, and then I got a book that they had, because we put midshipmen on there, and we had a midshipman book that they printed up for them, and every sailor on the ship stole one. So I had it, I started reading it, This thing weighs 87,000 ton. My God! I was afraid it was going to sink. When the minute they pulled it away from their dock, but away we went. Mm-hmm. We were gone for 6 months. In the 2 years I was on that ship, I spent 30 days back in the United States. We traveled all across the Med, and we were in Scotland and all that. It was a great experience. I was a young kid, and I knew what I wanted to do with my life, but I never imagined it would be anything like that. Mm-hmm. The second greatest thing in my life was when I went on the honor flight with the veterans. Mm-hmm. And it was down in Washington, and that was great.
So let's go back and talk about, you said you had several jobs on the battleship. Why don't you talk about a little bit about each one of those, what you did, and then finish off with telling us about what it was like to work in Engine Room 1 as a machinist mate. So just kind of recap your professional experience on the battleship.
Well, there was a bunch of us. There were I probably was one of the oldest ones, and they were 18, 19-year-old kids. And I had never done anything like that before. I mean, one day a guy says to me, you gotta go in the boiler. I looked at him and I said, what? He says, you have to go to the boiler. You're gonna punch the tubes. I said, I'm gonna what? You know me, I don't know what I was talking about. And they give you a brush with a handle on it about 12 foot long, and the pipe was about that big as the tube is in. And you got to shove it in there and get all the carbon out of it to fire it. And I thought, holy crap, this is a crazy job. But I didn't like it. It was too dirty. So then the next couple weeks later, a guy says to me, I'm going to bring you downstairs with the machinist mates. You don't want to go in there, boiler. I said, you're not kidding. So then they taught me how to repair steam valves and all that, the seats and all. And it was a heck of an experience, and I really enjoyed it. And if I had my chance to do it, I'd go do it again. And I'd stay forever.
So what were the conditions like working in Engine Room 1?
What, pardon me?
The conditions working in Engine Room 1, what was that like?
Oh, there was things that only, the engine room was a big room, and they had a motor in it, or a turbine in it, and they had big mammoth generator in there on one side, and then you were hooked up to the boiler room, and they had a big thing on the wall that told you what the steam pressure was in the boiler and all that. And everything come down up on a bridge, they told you reverse, forward, and so on and so forth. And if you didn't pay any attention to what you were doing, you were in trouble. You know, because you had to turn one valve this way to open it up to put the steam into the boiler or into the generator or the engine, and then to make the turbine work and all that. And we were out one night, and the admiral that was on it, he wanted to pull a full power run. So we did. Shoved it down in the flank, and we opened it all up, and boom, about 10 minutes later, he called us down. Congratulations, you just pulled out the convoy. Now, and, you know, there was various things that you did that were funny, and there were various things that, if you got caught, you were really in trouble.
Okay. What about your general quarters and your watch stations? What were they like? And where did you have those? Where were you stationed?
My My general quarter station was down in the after, I forget what they called it now, where they put the shaft went through the stern of the ship. And that thing is, let me tell you, that is down. Mm-hmm. You can put your hand on a water, on a steel bunk like that, and it's got ice on it. And then they put you in there, and they're about as big as a bathroom. And they close the door, you got to close the steel door, the watertight door, and you got to make sure that the shaft is turning in the way they want it. The guy on the phone, you're sitting there on the phone, and he's telling you, well, you gotta, you're missing. And you tell him, well, it's being controlled from up above. And, but I didn't like it because I was claustrophobic. And when they get me down there and you're all alone, and they slam that door behind just like going to jail. But I survived.
All right, so let's talk about some lighter things. Like, how about just general life on board the ship? Do you have any stories about some friends or some things like that on the ship? Everyday life, you can describe that.
Most of the guys were very friendly, and there was so many of you there. There was 1,100, 1,200 people. Guys on the ship, you don't have time to fight. The only ones you fight with is the Marines. They sit there and shine their shoes and polish their buckles and clean their guns and all that up on a deck, and here you are, you're a dumb sailor, you're just with a brush. But I had friends in the Marine Corps that lived up home up there by me, and we used to come back, go back and forth there. When we had time, or were able to. And I had friends in New York, and it was all right. I'd do it. Like I said, I'd do it again.
All right. So, how about the food on board? How was it?
I never ate steak and eggs until I joined the Navy.
And?
And they were great.
Okay. Anything else you remember from something as simple as your chow call, or getting up and getting ready for the day? What was that like?
Getting up for and ready for the day?
Every day, yeah. Everyday life.
There were days that if you were at sea, the engineering crew people had it easy because they were awake. If you may draw the watch at night, from 12 to 4. So they give you a chance to sleep in, and you could, it depended how far how long or whatever you were doing. If they went to general quarters, it could be a general quarters, it's 4 hours, 5 hours, and nothing's happening, and you're all ready to go to sleep, and the guy sits down and yells over the intercom, and everybody, like the ship is being blown up. But, and then we got stuck over in the med, because the ship that was going to relieve us got hung up in a typhoon, and they were late getting into Gibraltar, where they changed. So we were over there for another month. But like I said, there's many things that I did that people, you tell people, people don't believe you. Just don't believe it. Like we had, when we were in Nice, France, we had a fashion show to come out on the ship with all these girls in their new pair of styles and all that. And the sailors were allowed to buy things you know, like sweaters or like that for your wife, your girlfriend, something like that. And it was probably about $40 cheaper than what you would pay for in the store someplace. And the ports that we went to, they were all, it was all interesting. I mean, there was a lot of things that I see on TV and you can't believe what it's like over there. Then I like you're over there and out there in Istanbul where they're raising all the devil hell and all that. And Istanbul was a beautiful place. And Conrad Hilton's got a big ass hotel over there and everything. And they're all beautiful buildings. Then we were in Nice, Barcelona. We hit them all over there.
Mm-hmm. All right, since you're talking about porta calls, did you have a favorite? Any that stand out in your mind?
Any of the we had one in Weymouth, England that my father sent me a thing out of the paper from here, from Syracuse, and right across the headline on the top of it, it says, "Congratulations, the USS New Jersey just disturbed the Lord King, or the Grand Mayor of Weymouth's garden party." And I thought to myself, what the heck? I was there, and I read it. And I called my father when I got back. I said, what the heck was that thing from the paper? I said, we didn't have a flight over there. We had a heck of a party. We didn't ruin anything. And he laughed. But we were in Barcelona for over Christmas and New Year's. And we had Christmas parties over there. And we had to bring the booze from New York, or from here, to there.
Now, while you were at these porta calls, did you get to see a USO show of any kind?
Pardon me?
USO show? Did you get to see a USO show?
No, not really.
There weren't
no.
any?
Because we didn't stop long enough.
Okay. Now, did you ever have to... You said most of your duty was in the Mediterranean, so you never went through the Panama Canal? All right. Did you ever cross the equator?
Yes.
Are you a shellback?
Yes.
Would you like to tell us about how to become a shellback?
I think I was. No, I went to the Arctic Circle.
Okay.
I'm, what the heck were they? A polar bear or whatever it is. And they got a big plaque home, mm-hmm. like that they issued us. Congratulations, you now are a polar bear for, you just crossed the Arctic Circle.
But you never did the equator to become a shellback from a polywog?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. All right. Now, during your time, did you ever encounter any Soviet ship or aircraft or any adversaries?
Not that I can remember.
All right. Now, were you part of the crews the only time that all four Iowa-class battleships steamed together? Were you part of that cruise?
No.
Okay. All right. Now, what any other stories or anything that you could tell us about your time on the battleship, New Jersey?
Not that I can remember.
All right.
I could never understand how come the Admiral and the people were eating like kings and we were eating like slaves. Mm-hmm. But I guess that goes with the gold.
All right. Describe, if you witnessed the 16-inch guns firing during any training exercises. Can you describe what that felt like?
Well, the only training exercise I was on deck with is when they fired one of the 16-inch guns. I almost had a heart attack. Mm-hmm. I couldn't hear for 2 days. You know, I had been on it maybe 2 weeks, and they were down in Guantanamo Bay. And they announced that they were going to fire the 16-inch guns. I didn't even know what they were talking about. And I was standing up there behind the number three turret, and all of a sudden that turret just turned around and that let go. And I thought, holy God, I thought I died. And that's an experience right there. Then you watch that thing just move sideways in the water. Unbelievable. That was really the biggest threat and scare that I had on the ship. Mm-hmm. That and, well, we were in Glasgow, Scotland, and they dropped the anchor out there because we had to anchor out, and then we were going to leave about 4 o'clock in the morning, and they couldn't get the anchor up off the bottom, and they pulled on it. The front of the ship went down like this, then they turned it loose, and then it come back up, then they went down again, and finally they got it loose, and away we went. Mm-hmm.
Now, you were telling me about a little bit of an incident while refueling.
Oh, yeah.
Would you like to describe that for us?
Well, they come along, the tanker come alongside of us over in the Med. And I see them doing it, and I believe what they were doing. And they sent a high line out. Then all of a sudden they sent a big fuel line, about 6-inch line, hose across, and they were probably 25 foot away, 30 feet away. There were big swells and waves in between it, all that. And they hooked it all up, and they called over to the tanker, okay, start pumping. And one of the lines broke loose. The swell caught it and tore it off the side of the valve on the ship, and the oil went flying, and it was all over the superstructure, all over the deck, and there was a chief warrant standing there, and I can't use the language he used, but whoa, he was soaked. And that oil was hot. So, and boy, did he raise the devil after that. But other than that, it's really the only thing that I can ever remember that happened over there, that was around there, that was around here, that was ever a real problem. And that was just an accident. Mm-hmm. Because like I say, when the two ships are going along like this side by side, the waves are coming up even with the deck. And them hose lines aren't that far off of the top of the deck. And they just whip them lines like nothing. That's like in the book that she's got here. It shows them transferring people from ship to ship on the high line. They never get me on that. No way. I sit out there and that guy's bouncing around out there, blow, and he go down his feet hit the water, then they pull apart like that and up it goes. It's like being on a roller coaster, right? They never get me on there. Mm-hmm.
Now, during those Mediterranean cruises, were any of them with midshipmen, and what do you remember about their perception or what their awe of the battleship?
The midshipmen?
Yeah, what were the midshipmen like?
They liked it. Mm-hmm. They didn't have to do anything. We would work them, and we can want the worst jobs in a place, and they loved it. You pull in Annapolis, They bring them out on barges and that, load them on the ship. Next day you're gone. And they loved it. And you had all the great, they went to all the great places over in the Med. They went to classy towns. And there were places that they went that we couldn't go. Like over in Nice, France, in the gambling casino over there. And the midshipmen and the officers could go in. The poor sailor, he had to stay outside. He couldn't go in. And then they make fun of you, and then you run and kill them. But, and they got, you know, they give them preferential treatment. Like when it come to eat and all that, they eat at the head of the line. And I never see one, all the while he was on the ship, that had anything to do with mess cook. Never see him working in a galley. But they didn't need him. They had some good cooks on them. Good cooks, good bakers. And they'd make fried eggs in the morning with ham and, oh my God, or steak. My father says to me, how do they feed you on there? I said, kind of tough. And he said to me, why, what's the matter? I said, well, I had steak and eggs yesterday for breakfast. You had what? He couldn't believe it. But I liked it, like I said.
Now, who was your commanding officer?
You mean the captain?
Yes, captain. I'm sorry, yes.
There was...
You served under more than one?
Brooks was a captain at one time.
Mm-hmm.
Then they transferred him. And O'Donnell was a captain.
Did you get to meet...
I don't know what's in that book.
Did you get to meet either one of them?
No.
Okay. What was it like serving under either captain that you can remember? What was their style of command?
Well, they kind of kept the captain and away from the hired help. The Marine Corps kind of watching over them like a puppy.
Mm-hmm.
And you had to go on. The enlisted man went up this gangway, the captain went up this gangway. And the Marines were standing there, and were standing there on the deck and all that, and all their pomp and circumstance. But from what I've seen of them, they knew their business and they were doing their job.
All right. Now, did you serve on any ships after New Jersey?
Nope.
All right. Did you get out of the Navy from New Jersey?
Then New Jersey came to Brooklyn and sat in a pier in Brooklyn Naval Yard. And then they were taking it and they were going to move it to Fire Island. And Fire Island, if you don't know where it is, it's up by the state, Statue of Liberty. And that's where they got all the armament. And they took it out there, and they unloaded the armament. When they got ready to move to Jersey to go to Fire Island, anybody that got this was going to be discharged within 2 weeks. Got off the ship. Then he went to the Naval Yard and receiving station in Brooklyn.
So you did not attend the decommissioning ceremony? Okay. All right, so exactly, when did you get out of the Navy?
You mean out of the reserves or from the ship?
Either one.
Well, I got out of the Navy in 1960. Served my 8 years. And I got out of off of New Jersey on January 7th, I think, was 1957.
Okay. Now, since then, let's just do a little recap of your life. What kind of civilian jobs did you do? What's your family, career? Just give us a little background about post-Navy life.
Pardon?
Just give me a background of your post-Navy life, career, family, things like that.
Well, before I went in the Navy, I worked for a grocery concern in Syracuse. And when I was in reserves, I went to school, to high school, with a girl that ended, well, a person, girl that ended up being my wife in 1957. And we had five kids, four girls and a boy. And I continued my career with the grocery chain. And I retired out of there when I was 60 years old. And I had 42 years there.
Mm-hmm.
And then we camped, and we had the kids lived with us at home and that. And we were what you call a happy family, I guess. And then 2 years ago, we had an accident. Our mom, their mother, and my wife passed away. And these girls, and there's two more at home, and a son to take care of me. So that's all I can tell you.
Mm-hmm. All right, so looking back, what impact on your life did Navy service have for you? What was your experience? What did you learn that you carried into civilian world?
Pardon?
What experiences that you had from the Navy carried into the civilian world?
Oh, there's a lot of things that I did. I can't think of any special one right now from when I was in the Navy that I brought home with me. And like I said, my wife and I, we got married. I got out in January, we got married in June. And we were just like
hard workers.
Seven little bugs in a rug.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned a lot how to control myself and not to get in trouble. And I think I did a hell of a job raising the kids.
All right. Now, this is the first time you've been back to the battleship since you disembarked, correct?
Right.
Coming up the pier, when you saw her again.
You don't want me to say what I thought, what I said.
Not exactly, we'll let you paraphrase.
The only thing they ever did with this ship, they give it the wrong name. You know what BBB stands for?
Mm-hmm.
What?
It's actually the, stands for battleship, but it's actually the, BB is the U.S. designation for battleship, because the British also used a singular B battleships.
That ain't what anybody ever was on it told you.
I can't speak for what the sailors said. I just that's the official version.
The first word is big.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, the second one starts with B-I-T.
You say no more. I got you.
And I stood there and I looked at you last night when we come over here. And well, when we come in at a port up here, or at a port, headed for a motel. And it was all lit up over here. And I says, holy crap. And that kid says to me, there's your ship. And I looked. Ain't very big. Then when I see it here again today, I thought to myself, holy crap, that thing is a big tub. But no matter what you do and what you've done with your life, if you've been in the service, you take it with you. And the USS Jersey will be in my mind and my heart until the day I die. I watch it on TV when they show it. And, you know, you just sit there and you look. I got this book that she's got. Well, it's
if you'd like to, you can take it out and just show it to the camera. I'll zoom in on it. Is that your cruise book, sir? Yeah, you want to hold it up? Let me, give me one second, I gotta move the camera. All right. Okay. And that's your cruise book?
Yep.
And what year is it?
Well, it just says, it's everything for New Jersey.
Okay, thank you.
From the time it was in the yard being made, at first the number on New Jersey was BB-16.
Correct, that is the first USS New Jersey that served from 1906 to 1920. This is the second. And I believe I mentioned to you earlier that the name USS New Jersey will be active again in a few years because there will be a Virginia-class submarine. After the interview, I'll be glad to show you some of the display we have on that future new USS New Jersey.
The biggest thing that ever fascinated me on was New Jersey is when they had it in dry dock. I couldn't believe that they got something like that in one of them dry docks and pumped the water out and it still stood up. But of course it had a flat bottom on it. But, and here's the book I was talking about with the Miss Chicklin.
All right, you want to hold that up just a little bit more? All right, thank you. Got it?
Here it is, waiting, coming in someplace, and it's waiting for a crowd. Just as in, hey, when a doctor came to New Jersey.
There it is. That's when they brought it in.
All right. Thank you. Got it. And we can scan all that after the interview if you let me, if you give me some time.
He's going to go through that with you after death.
But they did everything on it. They had bowling and they had a basketball team, baseball team, played soccer. They had the whole nine yards. They get a, when we get overseas and they get to some country that played soccer, we had a soccer team. And they were pretty good.
Were you on any of those sports teams?
No.
Okay.
I didn't want to get hurt.
All right. Any last statements you'd like to make, legacy statements for future historians or students, academics who might be viewing this?
If you have to go in the Navy, you're in service, go in the Navy. That's my hope or plan. And like I said before, if I had to do it over again, I'd be right there.
All right. Thank you very much for your service and taking the time to join us. We'll conclude the interview with that. This is Angelo Pizzula, manager of the Oral History Program, on board the Battleship New Jersey in Camden, New Jersey. Today is Saturday, May 4th, 2019. Our interview guest was Mr. Carl Haffner from Syracuse, New York. This recording and any transcripts, abstracts, or indexes made from the recordings will be stored in the Oral History Department of the Battleship New Jersey, the Library of Congress's Veterans History Project, and the New Jersey State Library System. All recordings will be made available to writers, researchers, teachers, and historians. And this is Angelo Pizzullo signing off.